Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Taban, it's my pleasure today to speak about one of important acid-base disturbance. And I selected this title, Clinical Pearls, because I'm going to discuss the most important points regarding metabolic alkalosis. Always, we concentrate on metabolic acidosis. But today, I'm going to speak about metabolic alkalosis. So I'm going to cover definition and pathophysiology, because if we don't understand the handling of bicarbonate and principally within the kidney, we will not understand metabolic alkalosis. And then causes, how to diagnose, how to treat, and the most important and interesting part of the presentation is special cases and situations. And I'll be happy if there is any comments or discussions from the audience. And we have now prestigious professors like Professor Magdi Sharaoui and Professor Hal Wakil, and all of you. I think it will be interesting and will be nice presentation. So we started the journey in acid-base disturbance by this Zoom meeting this year in January. And in this video, we discussed how to diagnose simple acid-base disturbance and a mixed acid-base disturbance, and we concentrated on metabolic acidosis. So today I'm going to shift to metabolic alkalosis. Metabolic alkalosis, this is a very simple definition. We have bicarb above 26. You can find many definitions, and you can find different cutoff point for bicarbonate in different sources. So you can find, for example, in one sources bicarb above 30, or above 32. But I like this definition. Bicarb above 26 and pH above 7.45. The course of metabolic alkalosis is divided into three phases: generation phase, maintenance phase, and recovery phase. So this is very interesting to know which generate acid alkalosis and which stimulates the maintenance phase of alkalosis. Before I'm going to discuss the pathophysiology, let us go to the physiology. Regarding the filtered bicarb, the GFR is 180 liter per day. All of us know this point because it is 120 milliliter per minute. So, and the serum bicarb is 24. So if we multiply 24 by 180 liters, this means that in GFR, we have 320 milli equivalent per day bicarb filtered per day. So all these filtered bicarbs should be reabsorbed by the renal tubules. So renal tubules are very smart to reabsorb the filtered bicarbonate. The major segment of the nephron, which is responsible about bicarb absorption, is proximal convoluted tubule. 80% of filtered bicarb is reabsorbed by proximal convoluted tubule. Lobophilin 10%, distal tubule 6%, and the last tuning by collecting duct 4% of the filtered bicarbonate. So this is how the kidney maintain the filtered bicarbonate. If we look at proximal convoluted tubule, they just show here we have filtered bicarbonate that binds hydrogen. This is in the lumen of proximal convoluted tubule. By the presence of carbonic anhydrase, H2CO3 is dissociated into H2O and CO2. Both H2O and CO2 find their way to the inside of the proximal convoluted tubule cell. By the presence of carbonic anhydrase, H2CO3 is formed, which dissociates into hydrogen that's secreted and bicarbonate that is reabsorbed to the blood. And here, please concentrate on all these transporters within the proximal convoluted tubule. The behavior of proximal convoluted tubules is like Lobophilin. Both of them behave similarly. But the difference is in the distal and the collecting tubules. In collecting tubules, we have two types of cells. We have type A intercalated cells, and this is how type A intercalated cell reabsorb bicarbonate. We have here chloride, and then bicarb is exchanged with chloride for the absorption. And in the luminal border, we have hydrogen ATPase. So all these facilities, and here we have carbonic anhydrase, facilitate bicarb reabsorption. In the collecting duct, we have another type of cells, which is intercalated cells of the collecting duct. Here, this is the lumen, and here we have transporter. The transporter here is not dedicated for bicarb reabsorption, but for bicarb secretion. So here, the bendrin, which is a transporter, this is an exchanger because it exchanges bicarb with chloride. So chloride is reabsorbed by the beta intercalated cells, and bicarb is secreted through bendrin transporter. It is very important. So all segments within the nephrons are responsible about bicarb reabsorption, except the type B intercalated cell, which is responsible about bicarbonate secretion. Again, this is the different parts of the nephron: proximal tubule, thick ascending limb of lobe of Henle, distal convoluted tubules, and these are the transporters. And here, the mechanisms for bicarb reabsorption. So if we have hypokalemia, reduction of potassium stimulates hydrogen secretion, and this will increase the bicarb reabsorption by proximal convoluted tubule. In thick ascending limb of Henle, sodium chloride reabsorption, here it interfered by loop diuretics. So loop diuretics interferes with sodium potassium 2 chloride cotransporter, and this interferes with bicarbonate. So loop diuretic inhibit this transporter, and by the inhibition of this transporter, bicarb absorption is increased. In this segment of the nephron, we have mutations like Barter syndrome. Also, chloride depletion increase reabsorption of bicarb through interference with this cotransporter. And this is the distal convoluted tubule. And these are the different mechanisms. If Barter syndrome interferes with thick ascending limb of lobe of Henle transporter, Gittleman syndrome interferes with sodium chloride cotransporter within distal convoluted tubule. This is why we say Barter syndrome behaves like loop diuretics, and Gittleman syndrome behaves like thiazide diuretics. Again, the beta intercalated cell is responsible about bicarb secretion. So if there is any interference with bendrin, bicarb will be reabsorbed. And then alpha intercalated cell. So this is the physiology of bicarb reabsorption. Again, we have these three important parts within the nephron: thick ascending limb of lobe of Henle, distal convoluted tubule, and the cortical collecting duct. This is a transporter that is inhibited by loop diuretics or mutations like Barter syndrome. So this is why loop diuretics, and in Barter syndrome, there is metabolic alkalosis because there is interference with this transporter. The same here in distal convoluted tubule, thiazide, and the Gittleman syndrome interferes with the sodium chloride cotransporter within distal convoluted tubule, leading to alkalosis. And this is the interference with the collecting duct. So this is a repetition. Factors affecting bicarb absorption by the proximal tubule. We have factors that increase bicarb absorption, like increased in the filtered load of bicarb, volume contraction, and this is the mechanism. You can see here the mechanism. So if we have increased filter the load of bicarb, this will lead to glomerulotubular balance is maintained so that a constant fraction of filtered load of bicarb is reabsorbed. Volume contraction promote bicarb absorption by sodium hydrogen exchange. Hypokalemia increase bicarb absorption, increase the BCO2, increased by carbon absorption, increased plasma hydrogen ion increased by carbon absorption. So all these chloride depletion also stimulates by carbon absorption by proximal vestibule. Hypercalcemia increased by carbon absorption. This may be due to volume depletion or through GFR reduction. So this is the all these factors increase by carbon absorption, while volume expansion, BTH, reduced PCO2, hypophosphatemia, acetazolamide, all these factors reduce by carbon absorption by proximal convoluted tubule, and this is the possible mechanism. So this table summarizes which the factors which increase and the factors which decrease by carbon absorption by proximal convoluted tubule. Again, aldosterone increased BCO2, increased plasma hydrogen, all these increase by carbon absorption. Hypokalemia as well, a reduction of BCO2, a reduction of hydrogen, adrenalectomy, all these reduced by carbon absorption. The second mechanism of bicarb is the gastrointestinal tract. So if we imagine this is the content of the stomach, so per 1 liter of gastric secretions or gastric fluid, the 1 liter includes 100 milliequivalent per liter for hydrogen ion and the chloride 120. This is why if the patient has vomiting, vomiting will increase, will reduce the amount of HCl, and this will lead to metabolic alkalosis. So put it in mind. What is the response to vomiting? We have two phases. We have early phase within the first 2 days, and if vomiting continues, we have late phase. In the early phase, there is increased bicarb secretion because this is the compensatory mechanism. And you will find urine alkaline. So these are the urinary electrolytes. So in early vomiting, in the first 2 days of vomiting, you may find the urine alkaline because of increased bicarb secretion. After that, the urine pH is reduced and the bicarb secretion is reduced. Why? Because of volume depletion. So urinary analysis, urine electrolyte pattern, is changeable from early to late vomiting, as I mentioned. So early, the kidney secretes bicarb. So you can find alkaline urine. Late, after 2 days of vomiting, kidney reabsorbed bicarb, maybe due to a volume depletion. Other chair of the gastrointestinal tract, you can find syndrome of congenital chlorodiarrhea. So this is a diarrhea rich in chloride content, villous adenoma, and laxative abuse. So all these causes can lead to metabolic alkalosis. So we have factors that generate metabolic alkalosis, either by exogenous alkali, and it is rare, or loss of hydrogen by vomiting, or the use of diuretics through the kidney. And then metabolic alkalosis is maintained because of reduced GFR. Why reduced GFR leads to maintenance of alkalosis? Because the kidney is not able to secrete bicarb. Reduction of volume and chloride depletion, this leads to reduction of bicarb filtration, increased proximal bicarb absorption, and increased hydrogen secretion. The same reduction of potassium and increased aldosterone, and increased aldosterone may be primary or secondary hyperaldosteronism. So in this slide, we have factors that leads to alkalosis and the factors that maintain alkalosis. And this is again the same mechanisms. Why chloride depletion leads to maintenance of alkalosis? Why potassium depletion maintains alkalosis? And why extracellular volume depletion maintains alkalosis? Chloride depletion leads to reduction of potassium reabsorption via sodium potassium 2 chloride cotransporter with an ascending limb of lobophilin, decreased bicarb secretion by the bendrin, increase the sodium reabsorption by epithelial sodium channel. So this is the mechanisms why chloride depletion maintains alkalosis. Why potassium depletion maintains alkalosis? Because potassium depletion reduces, as like here chloride, here reduces sodium potassium chloride cotransporter within ascending lymphoflux family, and increases proximal tubular distal and distal tubular acidification, and increased ammonia production. And for your information, why hypokalemia? We don't like hypokalemia in liver cirrhosis. Why hypokalemia is one of the predisposing factors to to encephalopathy in hepatic patient, because of increased ammonia generation by renal tubules. Extracellular fluid volume depletion leads to a reduction of bicarb filtration and increased bicarb absorption through proximal tubule, and reduced bicarb secretion via bendrin. All these factors can lead to increased and sustaining the release of bicarbonate and maintaining alkalosis. So this is the physiology. So the causes, I think it is now very easy to imagine the causes of metabolic alkalosis. We have either exogenous, like bicarb load, acute alkali administration. And here, if you see anything in bold, this means it is frequent. So the bold factors, the means that is the factor is frequent. So milk alkali syndrome is seen. Effective extracellular volume contraction and normotension, potassium deficiency, and secondary hyperrenemic hyperaldosteronism, because of all these factors, the most frequent is vomiting and gastric aspiration. Renal origin, the most common is diuretics, especially thiazides and loop diuretics, and edematous states. Potassium depletion, including all these factors. Other causes, extracellular volume expansion, hypertension and potassium deficiency, and hyperemic cortisolism associated with high renin level, like this, all these factors, renal artery stenosis, accelerated hypertension, primary aldosteronism due to adrenal adenoma, hyperplasia, carcinoma, glucocorticoid suppressible causes, and then adrenal enzyme deficits, Cushing syndrome, and others like licorice, carbenoxolone, and other factors. So these are the causes. Or gain mutation of epithelial sodium channel with extracellular volume expansion, hypertension, potassium deficiency, and hyperuremic hyperaldosteronism like Liddle syndrome. So these are the list of causes that can lead to metabolic alkalosis. And then the first discriminating points of the causes of metabolic alkalosis is to know urinary chloride, because it will give a hint about the chloride status. And I want, before to proceeding, to hear from Professor Magdi, because it seems that he has a comment. Dr. Magdi. Okay. So if we have metabolic alkalosis, we order urinary chloride testing. So if urinary chloride is less than 10 milliequivalent per liter, or high than 15 to 20 milliequivalent per liter. If urinary chloride is less than 10, and the patient is normotensive, here, this is because of vomiting, and in vomiting and dehydration, kidney responds by reabsorbing and conserving the fluids and increasing reabsorption of chloride. This is why chloride in urine is very low. In nasogastric aspiration, diuretic use distant, post-hypercapnia, villus adenoma, bicarb treatment of organic acidosis, because when we treat lactic acidosis, lactate will be changed into bicarbonate and in potassium deficiency. So if we have metabolic alkalosis, and the patient is normotensive and urinary chloride is less than 10 milliequivalent per liter, we are thinking of all these causes. So if urine chloride is high, we may have hypertensive or normotensive individual. If the patient is hypertensive, this may be due to primary aldosteronism, Cushing syndrome, renal artery stenosis, renal failure, plus alkali therapy, or Liddle syndrome. And we'll discuss how to discriminate the between and how to differentiate all these causes in the cases and in the following slides. Here, just clear drawing. If the patient is normotensive and urinary chloride is high, this is because of magnesium deficiency, severe potassium deficiency, Barter, Gitelman, and diuretic use. If urinary chloride is less than 10, we say this is saline responsive alkalosis or volume responsive alkalosis. This is because of defective fluids. If chloride in urine is high, this is saline unresponsive alkalosis. And we should think of the etiology as I enumerated in this slide. If the patient is hypertensive and hypokalemic alkalosis, we may think of renin aldosterone STH as laboratory investigation to know the cause. Suppose that the cause is hyperreninemic. So if we have hyperreninemic, this means serum renin is elevated and followed by increased aldosterone. So this is secondary aldosteronism. If we have secondary aldosteronism, this may be due to renal artery stenosis or renin secreting tumor like a reninoma. So we order MRA to know if there is artery stenosis or not, and CT or MR of the kidneys can reveal tumors. So this is secondary aldosteronism, increased both renin and aldosterone, and here hypertension with metabolic alkalosis and hypokalemia. If there is hyporeninemic, then renin is reduced and the aldosterone is high. This cocktail denotes primary aldosteronism. So it is maybe due to aldosterone secreting adrenal adenoma, hyperplasia, or carcinoma. Pseudo-hyperaldosteronism. This is if we measure STH and we find it is high with reduced renin and aldosterone, so it is pituitary Cushing syndrome. Or due to release of cortisol from suprarenal gland, here you will find suppressed STH. But if you measure urinary cortisol or measuring AM cortisol, you'll find you can diagnose the Cushing syndrome. The use of licorice, because licorice inhibits 11 beta hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase, and I'm going to explain all these points in one of the cases later on. Then we have genetic causes like glucocorticoid remediable aldosteronism, Liddle syndrome, and I'm going to explain all this in details later. So, clinical manifestation of metabolic alkalosis includes a reduction in blood flow, CNS reduction in blood flow, confusion, obtundation, reduced seizure threshold, so convulsion, tetany, reduced the cardiac output, reduced the coronary flow, arterial vasoconstriction, increased heart rate, predisposing to refractory ventricular and supraventricular arrhythmias, pulmonary, hypoventilation, hypercapnia, hypoxia, metabolic hypokalemia, decreased ionized calcium, hypophosphatemia, hypomagnesemia, and stimulation of glycolysis. So this means metabolic alkalosis can affect all body systems. So this is why we consider electrolyte and acid-base evaluation in medicine. So if we have metabolic alkalosis, this means that we have high serum bicarb. So what are the compensatory mechanisms? from the first video, we know that bicarb, if we are dealing with simple acid-base disturbance, if bicarb increases, BCO2 increases as well. So if we know the compensation, we have here, for this is a normal person, pH is 7.4, bicarb is 24, so BCO2 is 40. If the patient has metabolic alkalosis, pH increases, bicarb increases to 34. What is your expectation for BCO2 here? As I mentioned, if bicarb increases, BCO2 increases to reduce the changes of pH. So here, the delta bicarb here is increased by 10, and we expect increased BCO2 by 0.7 for each 1 millimole of bicarb. So BCO2 increases by 7. So if here it is 40, in this situation, we expect BCO2 to be 47. Be aware that we have maximal level of response. So the maximum compensation for metabolic alkalosis is BCO2 increases to the level of 65. Beyond this level, there is no further increase in BCO2, and you will find very high pH, and BCO2 will not be able to ameliorate the changes of pH. Here, here in an interaction, and I like Dr. Hani Mansour to interact with me. This is the value of serum sodium to chloride. Normally, serum sodium is 140, and the chloride 100. So the ratio is 1:4:1. How can we use sodium to chloride ratio to tell us about the volume status and the presence of acid-base disturbance? Dr. Hani. Dr. Hani? It seems that he has a problem. Doctor, so anyone wants to interact? So sodium is a representative of base, and the chloride is a representative of acid. The ratio is 1:4:1. So if we find in the patient lab, sodium to chloride, the ratio is above 1:4:1, so this is a case of alkalosis. If the patient is overloaded, overhydrated, so we expect, if this is a normal person, both sodium and the chloride will be reduced to the same extent, keeping ratio in a normal state, 1:4:1. So here, this is the data. In metabolic alkalosis, here the change of sodium is nice, and chloride is reduced. So the ratio will be above 1:4:1. So this is a case of metabolic, we can expect it is a metabolic alkalosis. So we can expect acid-base disturbance just looking at sodium and chloride in the serum. If the patient is overhydrated, just overhydration, this will dilute both sodium and chloride, keeping the ratio 1:4:1. So if we find sodium 126 and chloride 90, the ratio is 1:4:1. This means overhydration and no acid-base disturbance. But if it is like this, sodium is reduced to 126 and the chloride is reduced to 80, this means that the ratio becomes more than 1:4:1. So here, we expect metabolic alkalosis plus overhydration. The opposite in dehydration. If sodium, both of them increases, but the ratio is stable, this is dehydration without acid-base disturbance. But dehydration and the metabolic alkalosis, here there is more increase in sodium. So both of them are increased, but sodium increased more than chloride. Again, if we have metabolic alkalosis, we should look at urinary chloride. either to have urinary chloride less than 20, so we are in chloride responsive alkalosis, all these factors, like I mentioned before. If chloride is above 20, so we are in chloride unresponsive alkalosis. If we are here, how to follow an algorithm to know the causes? We order urinary potassium. If urinary potassium is low, this means that losses are through the gastrointestinal tract or deficiency of potassium, so severe potassium depletion or laxative abuse. If urinary potassium is high, then we should shift to blood pressure measurement. Is it low or normal? So we are, this may be Barthard's, Gitelman, or diuretic abuse. Or blood pressure is high, in this moment we measure renin. If renin is high, we measure aldosterone. So if renin and aldosterone are high, this is secondary aldosteronism. If renin is low and the aldosterone is high, this is primary aldosteronism. If both of them are low, this is maybe Cushing and other causes that I'm going to mention later. So this is the test, just to show you. Serum renin aldosterone, here in Barter syndrome, Gitelman syndrome. In these two syndromes, you'll find renin and aldosterone are increased. Primary aldosteronism, aldosterone is high, and renin is suppressed. In secondary aldosteronism, renin is high, and aldosterone is increased because renin is increased. In apparent mineralocorticoid excess, licorice and Cushing syndrome, both renin and aldosterone are reduced. Then we look at the various data to know where we are. Please fix this, if you look at this video, fix this table and look in details to see the parameters of urine electrolytes and how everything is gone. How to treat metabolic alkalosis? It is very simple to both this algorithm, treating the cause, giving normal saline, because we say volume responsive alkalosis, so we should think of dehydration and giving replenishment of the fluids, so sodium chloride will correct alkalosis. And we know that one of side effects of sodium chloride, isotonic saline, it may cause hyperchloremic acidosis, this in general. But so here, it will be the best treatment to replenish fluids by sodium isotonic saline. We should correct the potassium, because severe hypokalemia will maintain alkalosis, as I mentioned in the pathophysiology. And then Ringer lactate. Do you agree about Ringer lactate? Dr. Mu'tasim. Mu'tasim?
أيوة مع حضرتك الحين.
Do you agree about Ringer lactate? دكتور هاني منصور افتح عليها معتصم.
تمام.
دكتور هاني.
No, because I think lactate later will be converted into bicarb, so alkalosis will be
so worse. If we use Ringer lactate, we should use it cautiously. So I bought here question mark, because lactate, as you mentioned, Dr. Hani, is converted into bicarbonate, and this will add to the problem of maintenance of alkalosis later on. So we can give Ringer lactate, but in a very cautious manner. The superiority is to replenish fluids by giving isotonic saline, and the potassium by giving potassium chloride. At the end of the day, if we have severe alkalosis, and the here we can use HCl. I don't have any experience with HCl, and I don't know if Professor Magdi has any experience with the using of HCl. Do you have experience, Dr. Magdi, with HCl?
لا لا, حتى برا مصر, even if not in Egypt, we haven't used it.
Okay, I agree with you, because
it's just in the textbook.
Yes, this is why I bought it. Yes, thank you, Dr. Magdi, because I didn't see HCl as a drug. But if it is used, if the sodium chloride and the potassium chloride administration are contraindicated. I don't know a contraindication for these fluids. So long as I have a hypokalemia and alkalosis, I don't think so. It may be due to hypervolemia, yes, maybe. But if it is available, should be given cautious, intravenous, in big vein, avoid extravasation, giving a small dose, and there is an equation, just few correction to correct this. If we have very high bicarbonate, we can reduce it by 6 millimole, like this equation. So long as we don't have exuberance, I go through this bicarb, this HCl. Then NH4Cl, ammonium chloride, again, I don't have any experience with ammonium chloride. And I know that there was a test for renal function about the ammonium chloride, but we don't use it. It is contraindicated in hepatic and renal failure. Acetazolamide may be used because it is a special type of diuretics. Here I want to ask one of the audience, Dr. Mu'tasim. Dr. Mu'tasim, is there a difference between acetazolamide and furosemide? Why we don't use thiazide, but we use acetazolamide? Do you know the difference? Because the major difference is acetazolamide leads to bicarbonaturia, increased bicarb secretion. But thiazide, if you use in a patient with hypokalemia and volume depletion thiazide, this will increase the problem of metabolic alkalosis. And this is why diuretics like thiazide and the loop diuretics are among the causes of metabolic alkalosis. So if we use, we can use acetazolamide in the presence of volume overload because we don't like to give fluids and a normal renal function. Again, the experience with the use of acetazolamide for treating metabolic alkalosis is very limited. In cases of renal failure, hemodialysis, peritoneal dialysis, or hemodiafiltration. So if we have renal failure and the patient overloaded and you have severe metabolic alkalosis, we can think of renal replacement therapy and adjusting the dialysate in the bicarb to reduce the serum bicarbonate. In suction and the protracted vomiting, if the patient has severe vomiting and in suction, we can use H2 receptor blockers and or proton pump inhibitors to decrease the losses of HCl of the stomach. In Zollinger-Ellison syndrome of gastrinoma, octreotide can be used to reduce hypergastrinemia. Please, I want your interaction in the coming sector, and this is the most important part in presentation. Before, as you see in the poll, there was a question about electrolyte and acid-base disturbance that may accompany cancer. So if we are requested in oncology department, we should think of the kidney function, creatinine, not creatinine only, but creatinine, electrolytes, and acid-base disturbance. This is one paper, and I know if you look at one paper, this is an observational study, cohort study, documenting data from one center. So at the end of the day, it is one paper, not solid evidence, but gives a good idea because this is the number of patients, 25,000 cancer patients. Electrolyte and acid-base disturbance were documented in 58% of the cases. So it is common to find electrolyte and acid-base disturbance when we think of cancer therapy. The most common electrolyte disturbance in this cohort of patients is hypocalcemia, as you see here, followed by hypophosphatemia, and then hyponatremia. So these are the most common electrolyte disturbance that you can see in cancer patients, not restricted to hyponatremia, because we are aware of hyponatremia, and we are aware by hypercalcemia. But here, as you see here, all electrolyte disturbances can be encountered in cancer patients. And then, combined metabolic acidosis and alkalosis is relatively common, 30%. And alkalosis is 22%. So metabolic alkalosis is common in cancer patients. And this is the heat map of different cancers. And if you go here, this is metabolic alkalosis and combination of metabolic acidosis and alkalosis in different cancers. You can see the cancer and you can see the percentage. Always the percentage is there, is high. So here, 58% of multiple myeloma, there is acid-base disturbance. So this means if we are requested in oncology, we should think of kidney function, including full pattern of electrolytes and acid-base disturbance. In hospital mortality, this is the most important points. Electrolyte disturbance in cancer are associated with increased risk of mortality. Dr. Magda may say it is association. Yes, I agree this association, but to be respected. So hyperkalemia is very important. And we know in tumor lysis syndrome, for example, the most important electrolyte disturbance is hyperkalemia. It is fatal, maybe fatal. So hyperkalemia, alkalemia and metabolic acidosis are associated as well with increased mortality. So should be aware of all that. Then the more the number of electrolyte disturbance and acid-base disturbance the patient has, the more the risk of mortality. So because you may have a patient who has cocktail of electrolyte and acid-base disturbance, the more the number of electrolyte and acid-base disturbance. So if the patient has hypo and hyper acidosis and alkalosis, this will increase the mortality more and more. Not only the number of electrolyte and acid-base disturbance, but as well the degree of acid electrolyte and acid-base disturbance. This is a case. And this is an application for the first video. If this is the case, I want one of the audience just to diagnose this acid-base, this blood gases. Dr. Mu'tasim. Dr. Zayan. Dr. Tariq. If this is a blood gases, what do you think?
اول حاجه بالنسبه لنقول البي اتش دي كده الكالوزس
دي الكالوزس
735 745 يبقى نورمال
اوكي نورمال
كده نورمال وذ نورمال يعني
اوكي
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 بس عندي حضرتك البايكربونات هنا قليل 20 اقل من النورمال
يبقى
تمام إيه؟ يبقى كده ماشي مع الاسيدوزس اكتر ميتابوليك اسيدوزس
ميتابوليك اسيدوزس نيجي بعد هاي انان جاب ميتابوليك اسيدوز
هاز انان جاب ميتابوليك اسيدوز اوكي
اند توداي وي ار سبيكينج اباوت ميتابوليك الكالوز
ميتابوليك الكالوز يبقى حضرتك هنعمل الدلتا ريشيو
سو الدلتا هي دلتا دلتا انان جاب اكسيد اكسيد باي كار اف يو يو دو سميشن اف يو كومباين 16 بلس سيرم باي كارب سو دلتا انان جاب بلس سيرم باي كارب is now 36 exceeding 32. This means that we have combination mixed acid base disturbance, high anion gap acidosis plus metabolic alkalosis. And this is because of vomiting. So this may be lactic acidosis or whatever the cause of high anion gap acidosis plus vomiting. By vomiting, the patient lost HSAL and this combined acidosis with metabolic alkalosis. So this is mixed acid-base disturbance. This is a special case. Three-year-old boy, this is 30, three-year-old male, was admitted to the otolaryngology department for cochlear implantation plan with the diagnosis of bilateral sensory neural deafness during the preoperative evaluation. So the patient has deafness, sensory neural, and evaluated for cochlear implantation. The most important laboratory the parameter is severe hypokalemia, serum potassium is 2.4. What is your diagnosis and or differential diagnosis, Dr. Tariq? Dr. Hani Mansour?
I think you're talking about Bartter syndrome.
Dr. Hani Mansour?
The combination of deafness with this alkalosis, mostly Bendred syndrome.
Okay, so the patient had metabolic alkalosis together with high plasma renin. And elevated aldosterone. Are you do you insist now on Bendred syndrome?
No, I have to open the differential now.
To what?
we'll take the algorithm. If the aldosterone is high first and the renin is high, so it's due to, we can think of Barter syndrome can do the same.
Is Barter syndrome associated, commonly associated with deafness?
No, it's not commonly associated deafness, but it will be in the differential here with this high aldosterone and the high renin.
Okay.
Maybe renin secreting tumor.
So it is Barter syndrome type 4. So one because we have five types of Barter syndrome, and just this is a case remind me by the inherited disorders of sodium chloride transporter mechanism. We have neonatal Barter syndrome type 1, and the clinical features: hypokalemia, metabolic alkalosis, hypercalciuria, hypotension. Hypercalciuria because Barter syndrome behaves like loop diuretics and it is autosomal recessive. Barter type 2, hypokalemia, metabolic alkalosis, hypotension, autosomal recessive. And here the defect in the apical potassium channel, ROMC. Type 3, here this basolateral chloride channel, hypokalemia, metabolic alkalosis, hypotension, normal blood pressure, autosomal recessive. Type 4, which is associated with sensory neural deafness. So it is type 4. Don't forget that in the Barter syndrome, there is increased renin aldosterone and increased prostaglandin secretion. This is why we may think of giving the deficits of potassium, and sometimes we give sodium chloride to these patients, non-steroidal to these patients. And the fifth type is salt wasting, hypokalemia, metabolic and hypercalciuria, and it is autosomal dominant. So these are the five types of Barter syndromes. Other syndromes, Gittleman syndrome, it is in the apical sodium chloride cotransporter of distal convoluted tubule, and the clinical presentation, hypokalemia, alkalosis, hypocalciuria. Why hypocalciuria? Because it behaves like thiazide diuretics. Just to memorize it by this way, autosomal recessive. Liddle syndrome, it is a defect in epithelial sodium channel. In Liddle syndrome, you will find the hypokalemia, metabolic alkalosis, and the patient is hypertensive. Renin and the aldosterone are low. And if you give the patient one of the stigmata of diagnosis or to suspect Liddle syndrome, if you give a spironolactone, the patient will not respond. But if you go to amiloride, the patient will respond. So if the patient doesn't respond to spironolactone, then respond to amiloride, then the defect is in epithelial sodium channel. We do genetic testing, and this is Liddle syndrome, autosomal dominant fashion. So these are the inherited disorders of sodium chloride transporter. We have five types of Barters and Gittleman and Liddle syndrome. And this is just to remind you by the sight of different types of Barters, as I mentioned in the previous slide. Okay, another case. This is a 17-year-old man, a garbage collector for the city, is admitted for weakness, fatigue, dizziness, and occasional left knee pain. Please, if you find a patient with undue fatigue, we should know the electrolytes and acid base. He craves Chinese food. He has no history of hypertension and doesn't use illicit drugs or alcohol. Blood pressure 160, this means he is normotensive or toward the hypotension. This is the setting. So this is Bosch hypotension. So the patient has Bosch hypotension. He has left knee tenderness, and the laboratory parameter shows these data. Sodium is 126, potassium 1.8, chloride is 82, bicarb is very high, 36, and this is the rest of investigations. The question is, what is your interpretation for this electrolyte disturbance, and what is the diagnosis? Dr. Hani Mansour raises his hand. Okay, Hani.
So this is metabolic alkalosis. Yes. with hypokalemia and low blood pressure.
Okay. We look for I like to follow the algorithm. So this is metabolic alkalosis. Okay. Where is chloride here?
Urinary chloride here is high.
Very high.
It's high.
Although the patient has Bushra hypotension, but urinary chloride is very high. This means that the kidney is the source of losses. Then look at potassium. Serum potassium is very low, and urinary potassium is very high. So this is inappropriate. This means kidney is the reason of all these deficits. Okay. Then.
Yes. Then we'll go to calcium creatinine ratio. Here calcium is low, so mostly it is Gitelman syndrome.
And fraction excretion of magnesium is high, so there is hypomagnesemia, and this is one of the criteria. Yes. So in this case, this is the diagnosis, because we have hypotension. The diagnosis is Gitelman syndrome. So if we select it, it's Gitelman syndrome based on the characteristic of Gitelman. Gitelman is characterized by hypomagnesemia, hypocalciuria, don't forget thiazide-like, hypermagnesuria, normal prostaglandin A2 level, and chondrocalcinosis. So if there is pain, this may be due to the retention of calcium, because we have hypocalciuria, and this may lead to pseudogout. So again, the criteria of Gitelman syndrome are including hypomagnesemia, hypocalciuria, hypermagnesuria, normal prostaglandin, and chondrocalcinosis. In a patient with alkalosis, metabolic alkalosis, hypokalemia, increased chloride in urine, so it's a saline resistant alkalosis. Okay? A 36-year-old woman was admitted for weakness, dizziness, and inability to walk for 2 weeks. She has a childhood history of hypothyroidism and sensory neural deafness. She denied vomiting. Her medications include thyroxine for hypothyroidism and hydrochlorothiazide for endolymph excess in the ear. Except for palpable goiter and low blood pressure, her physical examination is otherwise normal. 2 months ago, her labs were normal. Current lab shows these laboratory parameters. So I want, which transporter is involved in this scenario? Is it sodium hydrogen ATPase, sodium potassium 2 chloride cotransporter, sodium chloride epithelial sodium channel, or chloride bicarb exchanger, which is the true? I want to, another one to interact. So Dr. Mu'tasim, you can select any one of the our colleagues from MD nephrology.
Chloride bicarb, Dr. Hussein.
Chloride bicarb, why you think of chloride bicarb exchanger معتصم؟
الهايبوثيروديزم مع سنسونيرو هينجوس ممكن تكون بندرين سندروم.
Perfect. So this is a Bendred syndrome. In Bendred syndrome, this is a cocktail, because Bendrin, which is responsible about chloride bicarb exchange, and it is responsible about bicarb secretion. So if it is defective, bicarb will be retained, leading to alkalosis. But usually, it is not severe alkalosis. And usually, it is induced by insult, like vomiting, like alcoholic, like any other cause, because it is mild in its nature. The problem is, Bendrin is not isolated in kidney, but it's present in thyroid, inner ear, and other structures as well. So this is why, in this case, we have thyroid disorder, goiter, hypothyroidism, and deafness, because Bendrin is normally present in all these structures. So presence of deafness, hypothyroid, plus metabolic alkalosis refers to sodium chloride bicarb exchanger or Bendren syndrome. The other transporters are not associated with thyroid or the inner ear problems. Okay, Hani Mansour wants to comment.
بأذنك دكتور حسين هو yes. طبعا الثيازيد هير اي ثينك اتس ا ستيمولس بيكوز نورمالي ان ان بندريت سيندرومز ذير از اوفر اكتنج صوديوم كلورايد كو ترانسبورتر
بيرفكت هاني بيرفكت هاني ذس از از اي منشن وي نيد اذر ستيمولس راذر ذان ذا ديفكت بيكوز ذا ديفكت از مايلد يوجوالي يو ويل فايند مايلد اتشينج اوف بايكارب بات تو فايند بايكارب 36 يس يو ار رايت The presence of the second stimulus, which is either diuretic or gastrointestinal losses by vomiting or other insults, keep and maintain the alkalosis. Dr. Rasha Kamal?
معلش. Alo?
Hi, Rasha.
بقول حضرتك هو بس مكتوب المسألة إن هي كانت normal من شهرين اللاب بتاعها كان completely
this is,
normal.
This is why this is an insult induced by added factor, either the use of diuretics or gastrointestinal vomiting, whatever. This is I explained that in Bendren syndrome, usually the patient is well, and if there is alkalosis, it's mild. But if there is another stimulus or insult, alkalosis become very high and severe. This is a 46-year-old Caucasian female was admitted to hospital after being found on the floor, confused and with rigid limbs. The medical history elicited from her family included childhood onset sensorineural hearing loss and mild hypothyroidism. It's okay, that has been diagnosed at the time of cochlear implantation 1 year earlier. And these are the lab parameters. Again, hypokalemia and metabolic alkalosis by carb 45. So again, this is a case of Bendren syndrome presented with severe alkalosis. And this is induced maybe because of vomiting or alcohol. So just to show you that Bendren is present in thyroid and is responsible about the iodide, this is iodide and sodium. So iodide and sodium reabsorption, and here this is, Bendren is responsible about iodide absorption to the colloid. Inside the ear, it is responsible about exchange with bicarbonate in the endolymph, and the kidney, as I mentioned, it is exchanger secretes bicarb and reabsorb chloride. So this is a case of Bendren syndrome presented with life-threatening metabolic alkalosis induced by factor. Okay, this is the four laboratory parameters for four patients. And here the task is to, this is an extended matched questions. So I wanted to say, to select one of lab parameters for each of the following cases. So I want Rasha Kamal. Russia.
Hello.
Hi, Russia.
Interesting.
What is your thinking here? Do the cross.
Serum sodium ABC match lab with craving for salty food and mutation in sodium chloride co-transporter. بيتهيألي واحد ده هيبقى اللي هو صوديوم كلورايد بايكارب
Let us think of vomiting for less than 2 days vomiting for more than 7 days
اللي تحتيهم يعني
which is the best fitting with vomiting from this table
best fitting
it is just very simple
for element 2 days element 2 days هيبقى B
yes
ولا أكتر من 7 days هيبقى A
so here chloride is low So long as urine is low, so this is volume responsive alkalosis. Volume responsive alkalosis is due to vomiting. In the early phase, the urine is alkaline. Because kidney secretes bicarb in the early days or in the early 2 days of vomiting. After that, and in continuation, there is a stimulated bicarb absorption. So here the urine become acidic. So this is the as you see here, this is the answer. Okay. Yeah. Regarding 18-year-old man with craving for salt food and the mutation in sodium cotransporter in the distal convoluted tubule. And this is mutation in sodium potassium 2 chloride cotransporter in the lobe, in the ascending lobe Finley. Then I like to look at calcium. If calcium is high in urine, so this is a case of Barter syndrome. So the defect in the ascending lobe Finley. If calcium in urine is low, so this is sodium chloride cotransporter. So the answer for the question, as you see, it is A3, B4, C2, D1. And I think you know the now how to interpret the lab. Looking at urinary chloride, if it is low, this is volume responsive. So I look at the causes of volume responsive in this case, it is vomiting. And according to the urine pH, I can say this is recent vomiting or continued vomiting.
More than 2 days.
Then urinary calcium excretion can explain the difference between the ascending limb of lobe Finley or distal convoluted tubule. Dr. Fatma wants to have interaction. Okay. So this is a case just to confirm the losses through gastrointestinal tract. This is a case of hemodialysis patient who presents with metabolic alkalosis. The patient has intestinal ischemia that ended with short gut. So, and here, if you look at the secretion, this is laboratory analysis of the fecal matter of this patient. As you see here, chloride is very high. So this is why the patient may have alkalosis while he is on hemodialysis. So we should be aware of the gastrointestinal causes of metabolic alkalosis, even in end-stage kidney disease patient. This is a 63-year-old male patient presented to a secondary hospital suffering from severe epigastric pain, vomiting, and diarrhea for the last few hours. Since many months, he experienced increasing fatigue and loss of appetite. Furthermore, recurring mild epigastric pain persisted since many years. A gastroscopy in the ambulatory setting has been unremarkable. These gastrointestinal symptoms had improved under proton pump inhibitor. After discontinuation, the symptoms recurred. Medical history revealed a diagnosis of arterial hypertension treated with lisinopril and hydrochlorothiazide. And this is the laboratory parameters. Anyone wants to interact with us? Dr. Mu'tasim? What's your interpretation for the lab? Look at bicarb, 52. Severe metabolic alkalosis. Yes. I think the etiology is clear. You have gastrin above 1,000, so it is gastrinoma. So it is gastrinoma and as a part of Zollinger-Ellison syndrome and maybe part of Mayne syndrome. So to put in mind, and for this case, the treatment is to continue proton pump inhibitor. Mu'tasim, if this is a case of a patient who presents with hypercalcemia, acute kidney injury, and these are the lab parameters. Read the lab and interact.
هو في حضرتك يعني هاي في هايبوناتريميا وهايبوكاليميا وبايكارب عالي 39 نورمال نورمال انيون جاب كالسيوم يعتبر يعني هاي وكرياتينين عالي 10 السؤال ايه طيب يا دكتور حسين
what is the this metabolic alkalosis what is the cause of metabolic alkalosis in this case and how to treat
الكيس اللي فاتت ولا دي كيس لوحدها حضرتك
another case a case of hypercalcemia acute kidney injury and metabolic alkalosis
syndrome
yeah
milk alkalosis syndrome why,
يعني why you say milk alkalosis syndrome because hypercalcemia may cause, hypercalcemia may cause acute kidney injury and hypovolemia may lead to metabolic alkalosis so to say milk alkalosis syndrome you should go in details in the rest of the algorithm BTH BTH related peptide vitamin D all these to go through and when you find nothing you will say mute yourself معتصم so if we have hypercalcemia then everything is okay then we have here measuring 25 hydroxy vitamin D and 125 hydroxy vitamin D and you find it is low both of them are low like this case so we are met with milk alkali syndrome the preferred name nowadays is not milk alkali syndrome the preferred name is calcium alkali syndrome because in the past the patients used to have excessive milk drinking but nowadays because of calcium intake the major difference between milk alkali syndrome and calcium alkali syndrome is in serum phosphate serum phosphorus was high in the early phases of milk alkali syndrome but because nowadays it is calcium alkali and the calcium is phosphate binder we don't to find hyperphosphatemia with the cases of calcium alkali syndrome this is another case of calcium alkali syndrome but the source of calcium alkali here is from the bandage with white powder so this is a wound and the white powder is sodium bicarb that can be reabsorbed through the wound again you will find severe metabolic alkalosis hypokalemia and if you go to the algorithm you will find nothing no malignancy and then it is a case of alkali syndrome one of interesting data about calcium alkali syndrome associated with hypoparathyroidism following thyroidectomy so these are cases of total thyroidectomy and with total thyroidectomy parathyroid glands were removed were excised with thyroidectomy so this is a report for 27 cases and this retrospective study revealed that there is high incidence of calcium alkali syndrome in patients with hypoparathyroidism after total thyroidectomy because when the parathyroid glands are removed with thyroid gland the patients will be maintained on high calcium so in this case this as you see hypercalcemia and reduction of the GFR and alkalosis in 70% so calcium alkali syndrome is there this another case I want to Hani Mansour here Hani Dr. Hani please read this case and try to answer and there is a trick in this case
طيب it is four and a half months old boy presenting dry cough since 2 weeks that didn't respond to antibiotics amoxicillin okay. He was admitted to the pediatric intensive care unit due to tachycardia and respiratory distress he also presented anorexia weight loss without any episodes of diarrhea and vomiting respiratory rate high hypotensive he was the first child of the family and his birth weight was 3.5 whereas at time of admission weight was 4.5 the patient was calm during the examination and appear normal with no sign of dehydration. Sodium electrolytes before the results, he is alkalotic. First thing, pH is 7.6 is alkalotic. PCO2 is 48, bicarb is 46, so it's metabolic alkalosis. Hyponatremia, hypokalemia, and chloride is low. Okay, so the patient had hypocalcemia, metabolic alkalosis, and hypokalemia. Urine electrolytes, urinary chloride is high, so it's renal, and potassium is low. Transtubular potassium gradient is low also.
It's a tricky case.
So here we have a discrepancy between the potassium and the chloride.
Okay.
But he has no diarrhea, right?
Is it Bartter syndrome? This is a question. I think you get
Bartter with urinary potassium is not going, but here's a problem with this transtubular gradient. I think there is some resistance in the kidney. Some
resistance to what? So I like your way of thinking because you are rational and you are systematic, and I like your style. And I bought this case just to show the importance of TTKG, transtubular potassium gradient, or even fraction excretion of potassium, or even potassium secretion. We should look at these points because potassium loss through the kidney, we should think, is it appropriate or not? So this is a case of cystic fibrosis, and there is loss of chloride in sweat. This is a case of pseudo Bartter syndrome. I'm not concerning by pseudo Bartter because it is not Bartter syndrome. Why it is not Bartter syndrome? Because as you mentioned, TTKG is less than 3%. So what is TTKG? Transtubular potassium gradient is calculated from an equation. So it is a net potassium secretion by collecting duct after correcting for changes in urinary osmolality, and is often used to determine whether hyperkalemia or hypokalemia, is it appropriate, if the kidney is appropriate or not. So if you have hypokalemia and you have high TTKG, this means that the kidney is inappropriate in its action, and it is the source of the cause and the cause of hypokalemia. To say Bartter syndrome, and the Bartter syndrome is a syndrome where kidney is the organ of loss of potassium, TTKG should be above 3%. If it is less than 3%, it is not Bartter. Like this case, it was pseudo Bartter syndrome. Again, this is a very simple lab parameter. I'm going to finish in 5 minutes. So we have here aldosterone high, renin is suppressed in a case of alkalosis, hypokalemia, and sodium is retained. So this is a case of primary aldosteronism. So if we have hypertension with alkalosis, hypokalemia, and renin and aldosterone, renin is suppressed and the aldosterone is very high, this is primary aldosteronism. If we have here the renin is high and the aldosterone is high, this is secondary aldosteronism, maybe due to renal artery stenosis. Then we have a category of causes known as glucocorticoid remediable aldosteronism. What is this? Because you voted that in glucocorticoid remediable hypertension, ACTH is high. Is ACTH is high? The answer is no. This is a case, a 14-month-old girl was admitted to the pediatric emergency unit. I'm going to discuss glucocorticoid remediable aldosteronism at the end of the hypertension with alkalosis after two cases. So this is a case of hypertension in childhood, 14 months, was admitted to the pediatric emergency unit for vomiting, fatigue, and frequent urination. So it is nephrogenic diabetes insipidus because of hypokalemia, low aldosterone, and responded to spironolactone. If you have a case, low aldosterone, low renin, and the patients responded to spironolactone, what is the cause. In early childhood, it is apparent mineralocorticoid excess. And I left primary, this apparent mineralocorticoid excess to this part to explain. What is meant, if we think of hormones, which is more abundant, cortisol or aldosterone? Cortisol is more abundant in the blood. And the cortisol have both mineralocorticoid and glucocorticoid effect. So if cortisol is left active, it will stimulate aldosterone receptor, leading to hyperaldosteronism. But what happens? Aldosterone receptor secretes 11 beta hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase, which transfers cortisol into cortisone. Cortisone is inactive on the aldosterone receptor. If we have congenital or hereditary disease like this one, apparent mineralocorticoid excess, with three patients in the family, have here have high urinary cortisol cortisone ratio. If urinary cortisol to cortisone ratio is high, this means that the enzyme is reduced. It may be reduced congenitally, genetically, or maybe reduced acquired, like licorice. So licorice reduces 11 beta hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase, increase urinary cortisol to cortisone ratio, and here cortisol behaves like aldosterone. Here aldosterone receptor is activated, so the patient will respond to spironolactone. If the patient has the same scenario but doesn't respond to spironolactone but responds to amiloride or trimethrin, we may think of Liddle syndrome. I'm going to buff through the cases. So it's another case of severe hypertension, hypokalemic metabolic alkalosis, and the patient presents with excessive weight gain, progressive swelling of both lower limbs for 1 month, polyuria accompanied by anorexia, tiredness for the last 10 days. Her face had a rounded appearance with extensive acneiform eruption. Hani, Turhani Mansour. What do you think here of this case?
Something like Cushing, maybe.
So it is serum creatinine is normal, potassium is very low, metabolic alkalosis and the bicarb is very high. Urine osmolality is 310. Urine chloride is high, so it's chloride resistance alkalosis. And then they looked at the renin and aldosterone low. The renin and the aldosterone in this case were low. So what do you think?
So maybe the differential here will be either Cushing or exogenous steroid.
You are right, because there was elevated both serum cortisol and STH. So this is a case of Cushing. Is it pituitary or adrenal? So this is the radiological data. If you find elevated STH, we think of pituitary. But pituitary examination was normal, and here was the problem. The problem is the tail in pancreas. There is a tumor, neuroendocrine tumor of pancreas, and here releases STH, so this ectopic STH production, with increasing the activity of both adrenals, and there is hepatic and lymph nodes affection. So this is the case of extra paraneoplastic STH produced by tumor, by neuroendocrine tumor. And increased cortisol production because of STH will stimulate a mineralocorticoid receptor through this figure that you see, leading to the cocktail of hypertension, alkalosis. And so we should be broad in mind. If we have hypertension, metabolic alkalosis, and hypokalemia, it's better to look at the endocrinal aspects. Here the patient was Cushing, Cushingoid feces and obesity. So we think of Cushing after exclusion of renin aldosterone pathway defects. And then by completing radiology, we diagnose tumor. Another case, this is a patient presented with psychosis, and here the problem was bilateral macronodular adrenal hyperplasia. If we go and think rational, we will diagnose the case. Treatment of bilateral macronodular adrenal hyperplasia is surgical, removal of the two adrenal glands. But here the patient refused surgery, so he was treated with ketoconazole. Ketoconazole reduces the cortisol, and spironolactone corrects the problem. So the let us go back to the remedial corticosteroid remediable hypertension. We have here plasma aldosterone. This is the we have four types of familial hyperaldosteronism. So in this type, where there is chimeric between two hormones, two genes that lead to increase the aldosterone based on STH. So this is the four types. Plasma aldosterone here is high in all cases. Renin is suppressed in all cases. Potassium is low. This is the inheritance in the four types, autosomal dominant, but chromosomal location and pathogenic genes differ according to the type. Just to explain, the first type, which is responsible about glucocorticoid remediable hypertension, this is the gene composition STH regulatory region plus cortisol coding region. So the regulation of aldosterone is through STH and not angiotensin 2. This is why if we suppress STH, so STH is not necessarily to be elevated, but it stimulates aldosterone secretion from the zona fasciculata. If we suppress STH by giving cortisol, in this scenario, the hypertension will be treated. So if we diagnose glucocorticoid remediable hypertension, treatment is to give, for example, dexamethasone or cortisol to suppress STH, and that will reduce aldosterone secretion. This is the last case. Licorice inhibits 11 beta hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase, which is responsible about changing cortisol into cortisone. So cortisol will be persistent. That may lead to pseudo-hyperaldosteronism, hypertension, and prolonged QT syndrome. At this point, I should stop and thank you for your attention, and it's time for your discussion. I want to hear from Professor Magdi. If you have any comments, Dr. Magdi, I'll be happy.
Okay.
Yes, please.
طيب بص انا طبعا very very interesting presentation although it is a very complicated one.
Yes, I know
very difficult.
Yes,
it's not easy for young nephrologists to deal with alkalosis.
Yes, but
however, we
the clear message, if you allow me, the message is to think of acid base. Yes, yes. And to look at, okay,
what I need to say is you need to think what is common.
Okay.
And there is two commonest cause for hyperkalemia that we shouldn't miss. Even alkalosis. The young nephrologist, general practitioner.
You mean alkalosis, Dr.
Alkalosis, Mike? Yes. Sorry, alkalosis.
Okay.
One, diuretic overuse.
Okay.
Which is very common, and it is the most common cause. Second is GI loss.
Okay.
Which again, sometimes is ignored. Sometimes a patient has diarrhea for once or twice a day, but for a long time, and he develop alkalosis or vomiting, as you discussed.
It is usually with vomiting, but diarrhea.
Yes, I know, but sometimes, yes. So you need to put things in the common, what is common and what's rare. Second thing, you have to have algorithm.
Yes.
Don't deal with alkalosis without algorithm, please.
So this is why I like the style of Dr. Hani Mansour. When he looked at alkalosis, then urinary chloride, then potassium, then blood pressure, then renin aldosterone. By this way, we'll pick up the majority of the causes of alkalosis. Why I was stimulated for this talk? Because we have a couple of cases who were neglected in the with our colleagues in internal medicine. Treating hypokalemia by potassium, that just until the patient becomes depleted.
Yes.
And at the end of the day with tumor, with adenoma of the subarachnoid gland. If it was diagnosed, if this case was diagnosed earlier, then will be left with a good state, and the patient can be subjected to laparoscopic adrenalectomy, and that's all from the beginning. But after a long story of depletion, the patient was in miserable state and is inoperable.
And also don't hesitate to ask for electrolyte in urine, pH in urine, and chloride, because chloride is usually not a routine test in our hospitals.
Okay.
And if you want to reach a good diagnosis of high of alkalosis, you have to ask for these parameters.
I think I agree with you 100%. As you know, I always agree with Professor Magdi. We should think of the most common. The common is common, yes. And we are nephrologists. And I remember in the United States, when I stayed there for 9 months, they consider the professor of nephrology who understands well electrolyte and acid-base disturbance as the professor.
Yes.
And even in Saudi Arabia, when they make interview with our young colleagues or our doctors, even consultants, they always concentrate on acid-base and electrolytes to gauge the level of the understanding of the doctor. So we should have training on these points. Common is common, and follow the algorithm. Yes.
Last comment, you have to know that alkalosis is much more dangerous than acidosis.
Yes, its severe form of alkalosis is very dangerous because it will lead to respiratory depression, cardiovascular depression. As I mentioned, all body systems can be affected. If it is not affected by alkalosis, it is affected by accompanying electrolytes. Again, there is no acid-base disturbance without looking at the rest of electrolytes. Okay?
Yes.
Do you have any question? Okay. Anybody wants to ask any questions? Okay, so nobody wants to ask. So I should say goodbye. Thank you very much for your good attention. And I suggest and recommend for all my colleagues, MD nephrology candidates and others, to look at the video to read and to apply, even as Professor Magdi mentioned, one step forward, it will make a great difference. Thank you very much and goodbye. And يعني happy عيد شم النسيم. مع السلامة. مع السلامة.
مع السلامة.